Elementary school teachers and administrators face challenges with online instruction and also prepare for hybrid learning.
We find out what a fourth-year architecture student...
Broadcasting from Swanson Studios, you're watching Mustang News.
Good afternoon, I'm Marcus Kakova.
And I'm Catherine Lane. And here are today's top stories. Elementary schools in Santa Ana are preparing to shift to hybrid learning next month. Reporter Ruby Tinkup spoke with educators about their experiences with online instruction so far.
Empty classrooms and empty playgrounds. This has become the new norm for elementary schools within Santa Ana Unified School District. For teachers and administrators, teaching children online during a pandemic has come with some challenges.
I think the biggest obstacle is technology and connecting and students having what they need. And actually, we're having a lot of trouble here on site with technology. The internet doesn't work, things are locking up. So a lot of days you're teaching to blank screens.
Engagement of students has also been a big concern for educators.
For little kindergartners, although they've been doing a great job, it can be very challenging for them to attend because they're at home. There's a lot of other things going on in their house that we have no control over. We understand, but it does interfere with their education.
With the district planning on opening elementary back up and implementing hybrid learning in November, some parents of students are still not entirely comfortable.
Well, the biggest concern, of course, is safety. And I have to, you know, that is, as we begin to plan for hybrid, parents are panicked. They don't know, should I follow what they hear on from the media? Should they trust that we are providing them a safe environment?
With some educators continuing to teach remotely, many have chosen to come back to work and teach in their classrooms even without students. For some, the shift to hybrid learning is very exciting news.
I absolutely cannot wait. I am counting the days. I feel safe in here because I think I'm only going to have about 10 kids at a time. Having the students for 3 or 4 hours, 2 days in person, I will teach them way more than I'm teaching them online.
For Mustang News, I'm Ruby Tincup.
Parents have the option not to send their children to in-person class. Ongoing surveys from the district have indicated that just over half of parents who've taken the survey are planning on their children going back to school.
Over this last summer, I met with some of the people who make San Luis Obispo something to celebrate in a series I've named Bone in the Throat. I hope to introduce you to these compelling characters and take you along as we go through their lives, experiences, and favorite places to eat and slow. This week's host was Jim D., owner of the Palm Theater.
I was born in New Jersey. I grew up there first 10 years of my life, and then my family moved around the country until we came to San Luis Obispo in 1965. Been there ever since. Maybe the fact that the family was moving around so much, I finally got some roots here in San Luis. So I went to high school here, went to Cal Poly here, and you know, started showing movies here back in 1973. So it's been doing it for quite a while. I worked at KCPR when I was a high school student, if you can believe that. KCPR went on the air in 1968, and it was, I loved it. I also work in radio. I met some people up at KCPR, and they were gracious because I wanted to do a show, and they let me do it. And so I did a radio show at KCPR like in 68 for a couple of years. And then when I went to Cal Poly, started there in 1970, my major was journalism and concentration in broadcasting, and I already had my foot in the door. Went on to thinking I was going to have a career in radio, but that's a tough one. I ended up having a career in the movie business. When I was growing up in New Jersey, my grandmother used to take me to monster movies. That's what I wanted to go see, monster movies. And I don't know how my grandmother did it, but there would be a theater nearby. I lived in northern New Jersey. It was a nearby theater. Like every Saturday, they'd show some monster movies for like 50 cents, and my grandmother would always take me. On the course of my career, going back to my childhood to now, the movie business has changed so much.
What is it about movies today that really keeps you going?
There's so much out there, and when I think of multiplexes these days, of course, multiplexes are now sort of paring down. I mean, back in the early 90s, they were talking about 20 plexes, 30 plexes. Well, that obviously didn't pan out. But still, when you have multiplex theaters with a number of screens across the country, you'll see the same 5 to 10 movies. What's done here at the Palm is not only are there movies outside of the mainstream ones, there are movies far outside the mainstream ones. I mean, again, I attend the Toronto Film Festival every year. They'll show like 300 movies over the course of their film festival, and a very small portion of those will play in movie theaters in this country. And there's this vast world of film that we don't even get to see. And if the Palm can grab a few of these things that will not play at the mainstream theaters, I mean, to me, that's my goal.
You can find the full-length story as well as previous and future installments at marcusccva.com. For Mustang News, I'm Marcus Kakova. Now to Sophie with the weather.
San Luis Obispo is starting to cool down after last week's heat. Stay tuned for more after the break.
See on page 4 that the projections need to be earthquake. Next Thursday?
Seriously, Thursday? Can't do that.
Uh-uh.
This is really inconvenient.
I have yoga that day.
I have no time for this.
So?
I can't do Thursday, but I can do Friday.
Disasters? Don't plan ahead. You can. Talk to your loved ones about how you're going to be ready in an emergency. Don't wait. Communicate.
What do you think you're doing, Kevin?
I was just gonna drive home.
There are several warning signs present that you shouldn't be driving.
Like hearing voices?
Like your text to emoji ratio?
Oh man, the selfies.
Selfie nailed it.
We all have warning signs that let us know that we're probably not okay to drive. Mine is pretending to be your subconscious.
Craig, come on, man, split a ride home.
Today's weather in San Luis Obispo will see a high of 80 degrees and a low of 53 degrees with 10-mile-per-hour winds. As fall settles in, the beaches are getting cooler, with Cayucas and Pismo coming in with the warmest temps, with highs of 71 degrees. And for all the surfers out there, waves are expected to be between 3 and 4 feet today. Now, back to our anchors.
And now here's Eric Villalpando with sports.
Thank you, Catherine. With the Tokyo Olympics being postponed for the first time in history, this former Cal Poly baseball player will have to wait one more year to get his shot at the Summer Games.
After pitching for Cal Poly baseball, Joey Wagman bounced around the minor leagues when he was drafted in 2013.
I was always the guy that wasn't supposed to be there. I was always the under-recruited guy, the not prospect guy. But that always kind of, you know, gave me the drive to kind of prove everybody wrong.
Despite not being able to pitch for the major leagues, Wagman's baseball journey didn't end there. His Jewish background allowed him to earn a dual citizenship in Israel, the country he will represent in the Tokyo Olympics.
Team Israel was one of 6 teams to qualify for the Tokyo Olympics and is the nation's first ever Olympic baseball team.
But the coronavirus pandemic forced the International Olympic Committee to postpone the event until summer of 2021. But Wagman's involvement with Team Israel goes beyond the diamond.
There is a small contingency of youth in Israel that love baseball and really want to get better, but it's just those numbers are really small. It comes up in conversation all the time. It's like, hey guys, we can kind of be those ambassadors, those, you know, groundbreakers for the game of baseball in Israel and give these kids in Israel somebody to look up to and you know, be those role models and everything.
Team Israel's long-term goal to build the sport's popularity throughout the country as well as playing in the Summer Games will have to stand by until next summer.
They had to postpone it. We were not going to be able to move forward the way that it was supposed to. And so if all I have to do is wait another year and then it's truly the Olympics like it's supposed to be, then, you know, it could be a whole lot worse.
For Mustang News TV, I'm Eric Villalpando.
We wish you all the best of luck, Joey. And now back to Catherine for more campus news.
Now to Kylie Kowalski about the recent viral video of Cal Poly students gathering at Pirates Cove.
61 Cal Poly students have recently confessed to being involved in a large gathering at Pirates Cove.
A video posted by the Cal Poly Barstool Instagram page shows a large group of students crowded together at the beach while two women take part in a mock football drill. The video makes it clear that there were no masks or social distancing apparent, angering many members of the community. Arroyo Grande native Rocco shares his thoughts on the increase in gatherings at Pirates Cove.
I don't like the disrespect because they seem like they just throw trash on the ground like that's the way they do it at home.
Cal Poly Media Relations Director Matt Lazier shared in an email with Mustang News that upon learning of the video, the university immediately began investigating and attempting to identify the participants in the gathering. Cal Poly freshman Shay Ashimala shares her thoughts on her peers' actions.
It's really disappointing because a lot of us are trying our best to not be in these huge groups of people, and then having people go and do that kind of sets all of us back as a school.
15 students living on campus are currently in isolation after testing positive for coronavirus, according to Cal Poly's coronavirus dashboard. Lazier shares that the efforts to limit the spread of COVID-19 within our campus and the broader San Luis Obispo community takes an effort from every individual member of those communities. I'm Kylie Kowalski for Mustang News.
Thank you, Kylie. The university continues to encourage students to wear face coverings in public, wash their hands often, maintain social distancing, and avoid unsafe gathering. With October now in full swing, cupping season isn't too far away. Stay tuned to see how you can still find romance during COVID.
Do you want to retire like a champ? Just like legendary basketball star Uncle Drew?
Don't do it like that, Uncle Drew!
You're already acing the game. You've got your dream ride.
Don't be slamming my door.
Sorry about that.
You just did this.
Do you want to retire like a champ? Just like legendary basketball star Uncle Drew?
Don't do it.
Looking to get back into dating? Well, yours truly has some ways to get yourself back out there. The pandemic makes it seem like new opportunities for love are just outright canceled. However, medical professionals say it doesn't have to be that way, according to NPR. If you're interested in a little romance, online dating is the safest way to start. After chatting with someone you like, Zoom dates and phone calls help with getting to know someone better safely. Infectious disease specialist at the Medical College of Wisconsin, Joyce Sanchez, says it's important to have a COVID talk about your partner's daily whereabouts and activities if you decide to meet in person. Meeting a new partner affects more than you, including your roommate or coworkers. If you live with other people or frequently interact with others, it may not be a good idea to see each other in person.
Because I don't know where these people have been, you know, they're strangers. You don't know who they've been in contact with. So you're just be saying whatever to convince you to go out with them. And I mean, your bottom line is you can't really trust strangers that you meet.
That was English senior Ashley Law. She spent most of her quarantine living with her family and decided it was not a good idea to date while at home.
Definitely. It was a little bit harder for me to meet people because I wasn't really there for like in-person events like they usually do for all the international students. Yeah, so for me, I felt like Tinder or dating apps or whatever was kind of a good option to meet people because it was really hard to figure out how to meet people on my own.
That was graphic communications major Kira Svinth. She, on the other hand, spent the last few months in Munich, Germany on study abroad, which began right before the American pandemic closures. Dr. Abrar Karan of Harvard Medical School says we should not downplay the importance of human connections because relationships are what keep us sane through something like the pandemic. So it's okay to put yourself out there as long as you assess your risks and are safe. For Mustang News, I'm Catherine Lane. And don't forget your masks, Warrior.